quantity by using the percentage. Because percentage is relative. 10% but let's say 10% means 10,000 vehicles, 10,000 new motorbikes in next year. That is different. That is what they call it. Don't use the relative numbers increased by 50%. This is one third cheaper. How much is one third cheaper? Okay. If you want to hide, you want to mask the value here, then you do something else. But you need to be frank. The raw value is
incidents or claims.
claim incident, claim report, quantity, rather than percentage, has to be general. Okay. I know to management, they look at this one, they understand very well because they deal with high level analysis. But when it comes down to the real numbers here, you need to know the dollar, the decimal points also. Sometimes. Okay. Okay, our friend here from Sukaisa. How about your measurable objectives? What do you have?
We'll take up to 90% of the whole area.
Correct.
Up to 90%.
To 90% of
the whole area.
Of our whole area. That is in the event of any fire, your system will be able to safeguard at least 90%. Secure or away from flames. Now, this commitment is on any budget or only for this particular project?
This project.
This project only. Okay, then we can talk about. I know, if I go along this thing again here, square meter or how many floors. Story. If it becomes a problem for you to quantify, if it's only if it's a problem to quantify, then leave it as space, as an area. Okay? But if you can quantify in terms of square meters, square feet, or whatever measurement you use, or hectares or acres, whatever you may use, go ahead. For those uninitiated, not knowing what you might say, 90%. Because I cannot. Just for 90%, I can imagine 90%. But your scope, the volume of the business is big. I mean, the plant is big, so I cannot imagine what's 90%. You can translate it to something that is more measurable than our own. Now, this is especially true if you have people who are not familiar with the industry, or not familiar with this project size. You cannot imagine how big it is. Or you can say it's like the size of three football fields, or whatever you mean. Just imagine that. Is there a time element here? What area? In 30 seconds of flame or until they extinguish? And is that I'm sure that you cannot guarantee the percent. Surely you will have, let's say, if the fire prolongs. Okay? If you leave the time element out, you can think, oh, 90%, even the building is burning for 3 hours, still 90% is protected. I think it's really impossible to grasp that and understand that, right? Okay, so that's why we have to do an extra mile to define the time during the intensity of fire and so forth. Okay, do you have one more? Within 10 seconds of detection. With the fire department, with the bombard, which is the fire department, regulations, compliance and regulations. Okay, what else? Regulations and that. What do you have?
Yes, which is NDP. Which is NDP. NDP.
Oh, to comply with NDP regulations within 10 years period from the date of handover. That means whatever system in here can have a lifespan, basically we're talking about lifespan 10 years before some upgrade or consider the quality is decreased or whatever it may be. So I think you get an idea why the element of time needs to go on outside. goal. It's called out of school. Why do we want to bother ourselves with our school? When we know fully well that whatever we do is in school, why do we want to bother our school? For me to justify this, let me tell you a story. Another story. I had a client who's actually into cabling works, doing cabling. It's actually all, most of my clients are from IT, or IT vendors, IT industry vendors. So we do cabling work. So he got a contract with a customer. The customer is just moving into a new building. It's all bare. So the customer wants to put the partition, furniture, of course, doing all the making sure that the local area networks, all those ports up on the wall, there's PowerPoint and everything, because they work with the furniture and partitions they want. Okay. So you need to put the infrastructure, power line, and so forth. So the vendor was engaged to do just only the computer networking cable. So the contract was signed, negotiated, and everything was done. On the day of handing over, the vendor brought the customer to walk around. I walked about that, because there's three stories. Okay. But there are 200 stations that are being assigned. The customer asked a very unusual question. Where is the power line? Where is the telephone jack? The vendor's jaw dropped. Why? To imagine a customer asking for services that the vendor is not supplying, and it implies as if the customer was assuming the vendor should be providing. It was spelled very clearly in the contract was just the computer networking, not power line, power plug, not telephone cabling. But the customer had the impression that the vendor had no sense. Since you're pulling the cable, you don't mind doing this also, that kind of thing. So what was supposed to be out of scope was imagined or thought is in the scope. Now, of course, the vendor has to case to argue or to justify. Let's go back to our contract. Look at that. Look at that. Yes, and he has a basis, okay, to justify that, to tell the customer, no, I have to do the power line. Customer said, what? Customer said, come on, this is the first time you're doing this business. You should know, when you are running the cable, okay, you have all this face plate, they call it that, where you have the thing on the wall. You have this thing called phone line jack, and you have the landline jack. And then maybe just beside it, conveniently, you have a 3-pin socket. At the same time, you should be doing that. Or at least you can touch me later. Or you can touch me later, even if it's outside your contract. Touch me later, no problem. It's at the same time, you're pulling the cable. This is the first time you're doing this project. Everybody's telling them. Oh, don't get it done? Sorry, I'll withhold my payment. Now, of course, how do you argue? Someone is going to withhold a payment. You know you are right, but this is I withhold the payment. I think you can okay? Even if it's not in the scope, fine, doesn't matter, consider it's not in the scope, I'll pay you extra by getting it done. My friend, you as a vendor, you have mouths to feed. You have vendors to pay off also. You know? And this delay may cost you another month or another 2 months. Who knows what kind of difficulty? Who knows what kind of new surprises the customer will bring later on? Maybe you ask the pricing sprinkler also the same thing. Who knows? Now, some of the things is, now, we don't know whether the customer was ethical or really innocent or being, seem to say that, unaware or this customer is actually playing a fool game. Okay? Pulling a leg. Trying to maximize the value, and blaming that inner. generous onto you. Why you want to get yourself caught in this kind of scenarios that may happen? That is why I deliberately inserted out of school to help you, to prompt you to think about, hey, what if I am a customer, a layman customer? What would have happened, or what would have misinterpreted or misassumed that I as a vendor would have been doing, should be doing? Okay. Of course, I can tell them one thing, but more obvious ones. Okay, let's suppose you design a motorbike. Okay, when you talk about things of safety in nature, of course, I expect the motorbike to stop on time and so forth. Okay, right? But the customer said that, hey, the motorbike did not stop on time. No, it did not stop on time on in place, but it actually skidded. Okay? And when I fell, the vehicle actually pressed against my lap or my thigh and skid along and have big scars here. Okay? So I want to sue them, okay, to say that even the way I fall caused me more injury. Okay? The design of the motorbike was wrong, whatever it may be. How can it fall on my body? I mean the designer, ergonomics or whatever you may want to call it, that's it. I'll show you. Now, you will take the blame, huh? Who knows, maybe they fall because they're too fat. Maybe they're too skinny. Or maybe when you're riding, you will let your, okay. I mean, you are not riding safely. So these are the consequences. So how? You want to get yourself caught into that? How do you protect yourself? Now, if it's a big bike, you understand, because the heaviness is there. But if it's 160cc, I don't know how, no matter how the road, you will not die on that. Right now, if it's a heavy one, yes, then that's what you have this thing here. What do you call it? The anti-skid bar. Okay. The big bikes, they have this thing protruding, one bar protruding. When you fall, the blood, I mean, there's one bar that that hits against the wall, so that is a gap, allowance gap, so you won't get your hip in or whatever it may be. Are you aware? Oh, okay, the microphone. Honda has it. Suzuki has it. Okay, this guy. So, just to get there, I know it's not your concern, it's not part of your case, is that you sign up for the bike, but you think of an extra scenario whereby to ensure that whatever part of school will also be somehow covered. Eventualities. Okay. I'm not saying that you must go at out of school, but should this be bringing up this as an issue for safety concerns and so on? They will say, okay, when I fall, will there be a risk of explosion? Okay, that's why you install this cut off valve, isn't it? When it is electronically, they cut off the fuel, and as you die, deliberately die. So this is a safety point of view to prevent the explosion. Okay, so for that, can you think of, give yourself 2 minutes and think if there's any out of scope you can insert for the projects that you have. Think from the layman perspective. Think of people, customers who are ignorant. Okay. You expect that kind of service to you, but it's not within the jurisdiction of the